yourself and your loved ones the perfect gift with up to 40% off. Check out Ana Luisa, you guys. I know you will love them. Okay, let's get into our case. Today, we will be talking about the murder of Nona Dirksmeyer. And she was this beautiful woman. She did a lot of charity work. She was dating her high school boyfriend. She was actually Miss Pettit Jean Valley in 2005 when our story begins. Nona and her boyfriend, Kevin Jones, were planning on eventually getting married. And Nona's whole family, they really liked Kevin and they were happy with the relationship. According to an episode of Dateline called What Happened to the Beauty Queen, her mother, Carol, was very grateful for Kevin because his presence seemed to really make a big difference in Nona's life. I guess in the past, she had struggled with what is described as bouts of turmoil. But with Kevin by her side, things were looking up. So, Nona had, been abused as a child. And this left her with some demons that she had to face. But it had also given her a cause which she worked to bring awareness to. In fact, according to the Chilling Crimes website, this was the reason that Nona had gotten involved in pageants to begin with, to raise awareness for childhood abuse. So, she has this past of abuse, but she's working through it, and with Kevin by her side, things were good. Like, he was loyal, he was always there. Kevin and Nona dated for years in high school, but then they graduated, and Kevin left to attend college in Dover, while Nona stayed in Russellville, Arkansas, to attend Arkansas Tech University. They kept in touch through texts and phone calls, and very much wanted to, you know, make their relationship work. On December 5th, Kevin hadn't heard from Nona, and she would usually try to get in touch with him, but when she didn't, he would reach out to her. So he sent her a text that read, quote, "Good morning, cuddle muffin. I love you and I hope you have a great day," end quote. But Nona never responded. Now, Nona did have big plans for that day. She was going to be meeting up with a young girl that she mentored through the Big Sisters program. But Kevin became concerned as the morning turned into the afternoon, and he still hadn't heard from Nona. But he also had a lot of stuff going on that day. He had plans that evening to take his mom to a Christmas party, so he couldn't, like, drop everything and head to her house. But on the way to the Christmas party, he's telling his mom how worried he was, and she's trying to talk him down, saying, you know, she's probably just busy with, like, last-minute holiday stuff. Later told him he failed that polygraph miserably. accusations with him. Police then went to Nona's mother and they said, look, the severity of Nona's injuries point to a personal attack. And then they said, look, we know Kevin is the one who did this. Kevin has killed her. And, I mean, this kind of makes sense to Nona's mother because she knew it had to be someone that Nona knew. Nona would never let a stranger inside her apartment. There were no signs of forced entry. So, a few days later, police held a press conference and they said they had identified the killer and they were just working to gather evidence. They didn't name Kevin as a person of interest, but that didn't stop the rumor mill from just running rampant. All sorts of stories started going around about Kevin, that he was a sociopath, just like on and on and on. Nona was this all-American beauty queen, and the public was outraged by her murder, which put a lot of pressure on police to solve the case. So, on March 31st, 2006, just 3 months after Nona was killed, they arrested Kevin Jones for the murder of Nona. His lawyers argued for a change of venue, and this was actually granted, and the trial was moved to Ozark. During the trial, the prosecutors theorized that the morning that Nona was killed, Kevin came to her apartment, walked into it using the key that he had, and they believe he either found a text message from one of Nona's other lovers or possibly a used condom wrapper. They believe expert who concluded that, I guess the way that the questions had been designed had basically ensured that Kevin would fail the test. The defense also argued that the state didn't really have, like, a lot of other evidence because the bloody palm print could be explained. So when the EMTs arrived, the lamp was laying right next to Nona's body. And the defense said that Kevin had just, like, frantically grabbed it to move it out of the way as he was, like, getting ready to perform CPR. The defense then went about trying to show the police had been completely incompetent while investigating the case. I guess the lead detective on the case had never worked a homicide case before, so this was his first, and this was brought up in court. Then they began showing evidence that had not been collected at the scene. They pointed out that they hadn't fingerprinted the entire house, only the area of the apartment where Nona's body was found. There was blood near the front of the door, and near the blinds, and there was a, like, condom wrapper that was found near the body. Now, police had followed up on the condom wrapper. They had believed that the condom itself had been flushed, and so they went upstairs to the bathroom to see if it had, or if it was, like, in the toilet, but they never, like, took DNA or fingerprints from the bathroom door, the, like, flusher handle. But the prosecution had built a case around this condom wrapper. They said this was the thing that set Kevin off, like, he found it and just went ballistic. They never fingerprinted or, like, DNA tested the condom wrapper. But the defense had. And the DNA came back as not a match to Kevin. And it wasn't a match to anyone in the database. The investigators believed that the killer had left through the sliding glass door, but they had failed to take fingerprints from the door. So basically, the defense is out to try and show the jury that the police had their sights set on Kevin from that first night, and they didn't even try to find any other possible suspects. Another thing that the defense did was they showed the jury that the prosecution, the police, hadn't followed up on kind of a key piece of evidence, Nona's phone. Nona's phone had been found at the scene. Her phone was found with the battery removed and missing. This phone had not been dusted for fingerprints, but whoever had killed her had likely taken the battery out because it was missing. So they're pointing out a lot of mistakes that were made during the investigation. The defense also brought in a witness, a plumber, who had seen Kevin at his home in Dover at 10:30 a.m. the morning Nona was killed. And the prosecution tried to argue that Kevin must have left right after this guy, this plumber, had seen him, and then drove the 20 miles to Nona's apartment. Kevin's cell phone had been switched off for about an hour and a half. Shopping with his mom when Nona had been killed. investigator takes everything he's found to the prosecutor, who is now a different one than the one who had tried Kevin for murder. And he's like, look, I really think this Gary Dunn is our guy. Look at all of this evidence that I found on him. And the state agrees. And they file charges against Gary Dunn for Nona's murder. So then Gary Dunn goes to trial for Nona's murder, where they paint this picture of him, of a violent man who had been stalking Nona, hanging out around like the outside of her apartment, watching her at night. The prosecution said that he had broken into her apartment in order to assault her. So, on the other hand, there is Gary's defense team who went to work trying to prove that their client was innocent. They said he had not lied to police about his alibi. He had just gotten the dates messed up because it had taken the police like 2 weeks to come and ask him for his alibi. And then they tried to point out that Kevin Jones was the murderer. So basically, the defense tried to put Kevin back on trial for the murder. And they really harped on the bloody handprint found in Nona's apartment that belonged to Kevin. In the end, the jury was deadlocked and a mistrial was declared. In 2011, Gary Dunn's second trial began. And the main difference between his first trial and his second trial was that during the second trial, the judge had allowed prosecutors to tell the jury that Gary was a convicted felon. And this information had not been allowed to be presented to the jury in the first trial. So Gary had attacked a woman in 2002 who was out for like a run. He saw her run by. He grabbed a branch, like a tree branch, and he hit her over the head several times. He just started beating her. But she was able to get away and call the police, and they came out and began canvassing the area looking for a suspect, and they found Gary Dunn hiding along the running trail. He was arrested and served 18 months for the crime. So as soon as he was paroled, he moved into the apartment across the street from Nona Dirksmeyer. This time, the woman who had been attacked was able to go to court, and her testimony showed that Gary Dunn was a violent man. He had no alibi at the time that Nona was killed. However, the condom wrapper comes up again, because why would he like break in because he wanted to attempt to assault her, but then leave that wrapper behind? Like, if he had been the one who had killed her, why would he leave that piece of evidence instead of grabbing it on his way out? In the end, there was another hung jury. Some of the jurors believed that Kevin Jones had killed Nona, and they didn't believe that it was Gary. The jurors believed that Gary could have had sex with Nona. She was having sex with a lot of men, apparently, but that doesn't mean he killed her. Like, he could have had sex with her days before, and the rapper just got left at her apartment. charges were brought against him. So after the hung jury, the state wanted to bring charges against Gary Dunn again and take him to court again. However, they decided to have charges dropped against him. This doesn't mean that it's over forever for Gary Dunn, but these charges, like, they can be refiled against him in the future. So Gary goes free, at least for a little while, until he popped back up on law enforcement's radar. In December of 2018, police were called to a parking lot of a First Baptist Church in Russellville to investigate an attempted abduction. So there's this 40-year-old woman. She was approached by a man in the parking lot who had tried to force her into his vehicle. She had gotten away and called police, and she was able to give them a good description of the man and his vehicle. Later that same day, there was another attempted abduction on the campus of Arkansas Tech University. Because the women in both cases had gotten a good description of the man and his vehicle, police were able to put out an APB, and soon an officer had pulled over Gary Dunn. He was arrested and pled no contest to the charges and was sentenced to 15 years in prison. And this is kind of where our case ends, with Nona Dirksmeyer's murder still unsolved, although it is likely the man responsible is behind bars. I just quickly want to cite my sources for this episode. I got information from a Dateline episode that aired February 22nd, 2013, titled The Death of a Beauty Queen, which was season 21, episode 26. Chillingcrimes.com also had an article titled Nona Dirksmeyer. The Arkansas Democrat Gazette had an article from December 6th, 2018, titled, Police Arrest Man 39 Twice, Tried in Slaying of Arkansas Beauty Queen, Prosecutor Calls Him Dangerous Person, by Stephen Simpson. THV 11 had an article titled, Man Accused in Nona Dirksmeyer Murder, Arrested After Allegedly Kidnapping Attempt in Russellville. And that article was from December of 2018. Thank you guys so much for joining me. Remember to check out Ana Luisa Jewelry. There's a link down in the description box. They have an amazing Valentine's sale going on right now that you are not going to miss. Have a great night, you guys. Please let me know in the comments what you think about this case. Do you think it was Kevin, or do you think it was Gary